We want to get young people excited about science. We want to get young people thinking that this is actually a better thing to do than just saying, I'm going to hang around a street corner till I get a BMW.
The SKA, when complete, will consist of over 2,500 radio telescopes. The signals from each dish strung together through fibre optic cables to form the largest radio telescope in the world.
I'm Bernie Fanaroff. I'm the project director of Square Kilometre Array South Africa project. The Square Kilometre Array will be about 50 times more sensitive than anything that's been built up to now. It essentially monitors radio waves from the universe. So what the SKA will do is to map how the universe has grown and how the structure of the universe has changed over its lifetime of 14 billion years. Astronomy throughout history has pushed the boundaries of technology, and that's because astronomers always want to see things which are fainter and further away and happen faster and so on. And many of the things that have been developed for astronomy have subsequently become very important in our lives. So the detectors which go into your camera or into your mobile phone's camera were developed for astronomy. The Wi-Fi networks, which we now all use with our laptops, were developed for astronomy. So we said, let us participate in the technology development, because then not only will we be establishing a capacity for doing good science, but we'll also teach a lot of our young people the very best, most cutting-edge technology. In developing first what we call this Cat 7, and now the Meerkat telescope, and participating in the design of the Square Kilometre Array, we've developed a group of young people, both in our direct employment in the project and in the universities around us, who have now developed cutting-edge skills in the very latest technologies. But a radio telescope is really in many ways just like a big computer. So the skills and the technological capacity we're developing are skills in very high performance computing, very, very fast computing. The SKA will require computers that work at what are called exaflop speeds. That's 1,000 times faster than the fastest computers we currently have. You'll have to transmit huge amounts of data. We'll store about an exabyte of data a day. Now that's like streaming 30 billion videos a day. That's a lot of information to store. We're also developing special boards, computer boards, for the first stage of the computing. We started working on them with a team from Berkeley in the US, and we've now taken over. So the second and third generations of the boards we've developed, we've built, and they're now being used in 50 institutions around the world. So we've now got a leading role in developing these very cutting-edge computer boards.
One of the South African government's preconditions for supporting the bid was that SKA be utilised for developing the skills of young people. SKA's Human Capital Development Programme has since 2005 awarded 544 grants, including sponsoring 6 university research chairs and the graduation of 92 master's degrees and 33 PhDs. They are particularly keen to support young black researchers, like SKA bursary recipient Enos Malabini Takalani, the first member of his family to go to university.
I'm doing PhD here in astrophysics at the University with the Department of Cosmology here at the University of the Western Cape. My PhD work is I'm basically looking at the extragalactic sources like the quasars and the BL Lacetae, which are the objects which are very far from our galaxy. So as for me, I just my interest was just I wanted to be a astrophysicist. So, and most of the times when even when I was young, or when I was still a boy, when people talk about the universe, things like the planets, I just get very excited about hearing about such things and to get myself, what are they talking about and what's really going on. So now at least I found a chance to study that by myself. My mom actually, she was just selling stuff on the streets, like these old traditional maheu and she will just be selling to the contractors and people passing, and yeah. So it was not like she was having a professional job, but she was just self-employed. And my father also was the very same thing also.
90 of those bursaries have gone to students from other African countries, because our bid for the SKA includes 8 other African countries. Because the telescope will stretch over 3,000 kilometres, parts of it will be in those countries. So we've had 90 students coming to study here. Many of them have gone back to their own countries and started to teach astronomy. So Madagascar is now training students up to master's level in astrophysics. Nairobi last year graduated its first 14 astrophysics honours students. Ghana is now teaching, Mauritius is teaching, and so on. So it's developed science capacity in those countries.
Start doing our acceptance test procedure, and one of the tests that...
SKA has been training African researchers on how to convert satellite communication dishes into radio telescopes. It was noticed that there are many redundant satellite dishes dotted around Africa, waiting to be dismantled and sold for scrap. Vodafone has given a 30-meter diameter satellite dish to the Ghanaian government. 7 Ghanaian scientists are currently being trained at the SKA office on how to convert this dish, with the idea they will return home to train others.
I'm Joyce Kwantinokwa. I'm an assistant research scientist at the Ghana Atomic Energy. And I'm here as the project manager for the AVN Africa project. Ghana is mostly known for football. Yeah, so to be part of a big project, a world scientific research project, it's good. Not just for Ghana, but I think it's also good for Africa as well. Because Africa has been left out with respect to these kinds of projects, so it's also a good thing.
My name is Emmanuel Mono, and I work with the Ghana Space Science at Atomic Energy, back home in Ghana. And my basic work is to carry out the electronics on the control and monitoring section on the antenna. We are being trained on the baby telescope that we term it to be. Since we came, we have been taking through the principles of the antenna. One of my dreams that immediately after here, when I get back, I'll find a means of getting a scholarship, maybe back to South Africa to continue with the SKA scholarship program to the PhD level. So it's an opportunity for me to be here.
We have to fix our basic education system. There's no question about that. What always surprises me is that students coming from really failed states in some parts of Africa and states which are much less well endowed than South Africa often come with a much better education than our own young people. We are in fact working with the schools around the small town of Carnarvon and the other small towns in the Karoo to develop maths and science in those schools. And then hopefully we can use that as a model. We work with a lot of companies, Intel and IBM and various others, and Microsoft. We put in computers in the schools and so on, but of course you don't want a bunch of technology out there with nothing underpinning it, so we're also working with the teachers and the lesson planning and so on. But you can't focus only on basic education. It's a bit like the old colonial view that in Africa you've got such problems you should only work on food and water and energy and don't bother with anything more exciting because actually, you know, you're in the colonies. And we don't buy that. So we don't see any reason, for instance, why we shouldn't say, what does it take by 2020 for South Africa to be a world leader in big data? We've got very good universities, we've got very bright young people, and we've certainly got the industrial base to do it. So yes, we should do it. You know, South Korea didn't say, we're a poor country, we're going to just focus on growing food. They said, we're going to invest heavily in science and technology, and that's what they're doing. So we don't think that there is a contradiction between fixing the basic education system and developing really excellent science and technology and engineering. And of course, you want to inspire young people. So we're doing not enough outreach, but we're doing more and more outreach because a lot of our young people actually don't know about science. So if you go into a lot of our schools and say, what do you want to do? They'll say, I want to be a lawyer, I want to be a doctor. Because they've heard about lawyers and they know what a doctor does. We say, why don't you want to be a scientist? Well, actually, nobody knows what it means to have a career in science or a career in engineering. We've got far too few engineers. We're not producing anything like enough engineers. We're not producing enough scientists to be a really innovative society. How do you develop wealth in a society? One of the ways you do it is by being innovative. You've got to develop scientists and engineers. Scientists like to go where the action is. When we started this project, there were probably fewer than 10 radio astronomers in the country. We now have going on for 150 or so. And a lot of those are leading researchers who've come from overseas to South Africa. So we're reversing the brain dead. If you can bring those people to your universities, you strengthen the teaching, you strengthen the research, and you also attract more of our best young people into science. What we're aiming to do is to make South Africa a center for the world's best science and technology. So we'll have a succession of really exciting discoveries made by international teams in a telescope based in Africa, which is the world's biggest telescope, the world's most exciting telescope.